lecture that I talked about this very important set of organic molecules, because of course they show up in our bodies and they are important for so many things. So So I'm being very general when I say this, when I say these three things on purpose, because the sugar varies a little bit, whether it's DNA or RNA, whether it's the deoxyribose, or if it's just regular ribose. This is the site where things are different, whether it's ribose or deoxyribose. But here, let me finish drawing the sugar here. Extend it a little bit. And then, okay. So here's our ring. This is the carbon example base up here. This makes sense, that if you remove oxygen, making it deoxy, that it makes sense we would just have a hydrogen there. And so this is the sugar that you would see in DNA, where D is for deoxy, and R is then for ribose. So one of those phosphorus oxygen bonds is a double bond, the way it's drawn conventionally. And then any of the oxygens that are single bonded to the phosphorus, those have a negative charge. And one of the reasons why we see the negative charge here is that at the physiological pH, at the pH of our bodies, that those hydrogen atoms would be lost, and we would expect these oxygens to exist as ions in this way. All right. So now, let's look at this connection right here to the base, all right? So that connection will always be to a nitrogen, and I think I'll draw an example where it's connected to adenine. That's one of our bases, that's a possibility. So, structure of adenine looks like this. We have a double bond there. And over here, we've got this double bond. And this is the larger part of the ring, another nitrogen. See how many nitrogens there are in these bases. That is a good thing, because that is going to allow for some very nice hydrogen bonding to be happening, which is crucial for As I said, here's an example of one of the nitrogen bases, but there are five different possible bases, okay? And I'm just going to first draw a really general shape, okay? This is not the chemical structure. Six-membered ring attached to a five-membered ring. As I said, it's very common to have it drawn sort of this way. Okay, six and a five. Meanwhile, the general shape of cytosine are smaller. These are the ones that just have a basic structure of a six-membered ring. Okay. Now, both of these, they absolutely have other functional groups coming off of them. They absolutely have some aromaticity. They've got double bonds. But I'm just showing cytosine being C, uracil being U, and thymine being T. So if we think of the word cut, and if we were to take this and cut it, make it smaller, that's one way to remember. Okay, so those are just our general shapes. And then I want to talk about specific structures. instead of thymine, RNA has uracil. So uracil is the one that hydrogen bonds with adenine. And I'm going to actually add a plural here because there is more than one. And then we have the combination of C and G, cytosine. This happens in both DNA and in RNA. And once we look at the structures, it's going to be very clear why these match up, and why these match up. So let's look at how these structures look and then how they match together to hydrogen bond, because this is so crucial in the structure of DNA and RNA. So first, let's look at this is the one of the smaller ones, and we've got the structure here, part of this ring that has nitrogen in it here. Nitrogen here. Okay. And then we've got methyl group here. This nitrogen, it does have an hydrogen here, so I'm going to really show that bond, because we're going to be focusing on hydrogen bonding. And thymine also has another double bond and oxygen there. Okay. By the way, this is the nitrogen that goes to the sugar. And since we are talking about D, this would be deoxyribose for the case DNA, but in any case, let's look at how this matches up with adenine, and we're also going to talk about how we know that it's going to match with adenine and not with the other larger base, with not deguanine. Structure of adenine. Let's start with our nitrogen here, because you're going to notice that when we line them up this way, it's always going to be nitrogen, nitrogen in the center of these molecules. I'll show you what I mean by that. Stubby legs, so it's hard for him to jump up sometimes. Okay. So we've got here a double bond and this is going to end up being a long this nitrogen has two hydrogens, but we're really just going to focus on one of them. This nitrogen is so electronegative, it's pulling the electron density away from this hydrogen, giving it a partial positive charge that makes it so attractive to this electronegative atom that's got a lone pair. Okay, so I'm going to depict this strong intermolecular force. It's not a true covalent bond, it's an intermolecular force. So I'm going to show with these dots to just represent that there is attraction happening here. Not a true bond, but strong attraction. So this is happening between the hydrogen on this nitrogen and lone pair on this nitrogen. And then up here, we've got hydrogen bond between lone pairs on this oxygen, once again electronegative, and the hydrogen on our adenine that's bonded to nitrogen. Okay, so as we can see, there's not anything sticking out here that can match with this hydrogen. So we only have two hydrogen bonds between thymine and adenine. And that is totally normal. That is exactly how these two bases interact together. I also wanted to say something about uracil, because in RNA, there's no thymine, but instead there's uracil. Well, what is the difference between thymine and uracil? And the answer is right here. This methyl group. Okay, this methyl group does not exist on uracil. But otherwise, the molecule is the same. And so, one way you could remember that uracil has a hydrogen there instead of this methyl group is if you think of uracil being un-methyl. So that can help you remember, if you can remember the structure of thymine and remember that this does not have a methyl group or it's unmethyl for uracil, that helps you remember two different bases pretty easily. Okay. So I should probably add that we have also just shown how uracil and adenine are hydrogen bonding. same exact principle. Okay. So let's look at cytosine and guanine. So remember our CUT, our acronym for cut, being the smaller base. So cytosine, I'll draw over here. I'll keep with this theme of having the smaller base on over on this side. And so here's our ring with some aromaticity. Still have an oxygen there. The cytosine has a nitrogen. It's an NH2 group, an amine. But again, we're going to focus on one of those hydrogens. So I'll just make sure I have the other one here, but we're really looking at this one. There's our middle nitrogen again. And now for cytosine, double bond oxygen group here. This is the nitrogen that anchors to the sugar. Whether it's deoxyribose in DNA or if it's ribose in RNA. Alright, let's now so my guanine, nitrogen, okay. So just like we saw up with thymine, adenine, uracil, adenine, nitrogen, we've got this interaction here, nitrogen, that interaction. All right, now let's draw the structure for guanine. Here's another amine group where we're going to have our hydrogen, but this is the hydrogen we're focusing on that will be interacting with that oxygen on cytosine. Okay, so let me finish our ring here. Got nitrogen. This will be just like what we saw with adenine. Okay, these two nitrogens. Okay. All right. And I want to make sure that we've got sugar. Let's double check. I'm missing a double bond here, so let me make sure I get that in. Just go around, make sure I've got all my bonds. Yes, looking good. Excellent. Okay, so take a look here, and you can see where we would expect to have hydrogen bonds. So analogous to what we saw above here. We've got hydrogen bond, but now hydrogen is over here on the guanine. feel like, oh, I'm so glad I looked back up here. I'm so sorry. I forgot a double bond here. I knew there was something wrong. Okay, good. Whew. I really don't want to make mistakes for you guys. Okay. Because I know this is relaxing, but it's also very important to me that all of this is given to you correctly. I don't want to make mistakes. So I'll try to keep an eye on and double check my structures. But this is looking pretty good now. Okay. So we've got Hashimba in the middle. But now we have a little bit something different. These are swapped in terms of oxygen on this side, nitrogen on this side. But we still that is happening between nitrogen and oxygen. And down here, we've got hydrogen bond between oxygen and nitrogen. So notice how in both of these cases, when we line up our smaller base with our larger base, have nitrogen bonding happening in the middle. And on the periphery, we always have a combination of oxygen, nitrogen. Now here, because there's no nitrogen, we can't have that. So that's just hanging loose. But here, we've got oxygen, nitrogen. Nitrogen, oxygen. So on the outside, we're always going to see a combination of the different atoms, oxygen, nitrogen. All right, and so the reason why I point that out is because if you are ever tempted to combine thymine or uracil with guanine, you can see what would happen is that you would have an oxygen here, and you would have an oxygen here, and you wouldn't be able to have the hydrogen bond. This amine group is providing the hydrogen that can then hydrogen bond with the oxygen, and that won't work if you've got oxygen paired somewhere. We don't see that. Okay? So once you really look at the structures of these and you think about what's happening with those hydrogen bonds, you can reason through exactly which of these bases will match up an hydrogen bond with the other base. This has been so lovely to draw these structures, and I know that there are other aspects of biochemistry and bioorganic chemistry that might be helpful, such as amino acids and lipids. So I plan on making some more videos with those structures, and I'm also happy to talk more about nucleic acids if there's anything else specific that you wanted me to go into. Okay. Alright, well thank you so much, all these comments and questions. Requests are so lovely. So, if you haven't already, and you'd like to subscribe, that really does help me. It's going to help me continue doing this, and I just enjoy it so much, as you can probably tell. Also, I made a personal goal to try to get 500 subscribers by the end of February, and I think I'm right around 400 right now as I'm recording this, so I'm on my way, which is very neat. I like that, and I do think that this helps people, because sometimes chemistry is taught in a way that's almost frantic, and it doesn't need to be. So many of these things, they really do make sense, and if you just slow down and have the time and take the time to look at some of the nuances and some of the explanations and some of the ideas of structure and of energy, then it really does start to make sense. So if you are struggling with chemistry, don't ever think that it's not attainable or you're not smart enough or anything like that. You absolutely can do it. I truly believe that. And I am here for you. So I will see you next time.